So in the last session, we discussed about the design and checks regarding one-way simply supported slabs. In our syllabus of slab, there are basically three portions. The first portion is of one-way slab, which is divided into two parts. The first part is one-way simply supported slab that we have covered. The second is one-way continuous slab that we will be starting today onwards. And the next portion will be of two-way slab. So total three portions are to be considered, and we will be starting with our second portion, that is one-way continuous slab. Now, one-way continuous slab is much more lengthier than we had discussed the one-way simply supported slab. So basically we will be dividing it into parts, and in today's session we will be basically focusing on the analysis portion and to find the moment of resistance of the continuous slab. So moving forward, the question can be asked as you can see here: find the bending moment for a continuous one-way slab having three equal span of 4 meter effective, each with the following data. The data has been prescribed in the question itself: the imposed load, that is our live load, floor finishing load, that is our floor finish FF, and the grade of concrete has been prescribed, and the grade of steel is being prescribed. Gamma F, that is factor of safety. In concrete portion, we always know that factor of safety to be considered is 1.5. If it is not mentioned in the question, then also we need to assume it to be 1.5. So in the question itself, there are some things that you need to look upon. The first thing is that the span or the length of our slab is given, that is, it is 4 meter effective. So basically the designing steps were, the first step was to find the effective depth, and the second step was to find the effective span. Here in the question itself, the effective span is being prescribed. So the second step will be eliminated in this case, as we have already given in the question that the effective span of slab is 4 meter. Our effective span of one section, it is given as 4 meter. And there are total three equal sections or equal spans of 4 meters. So the total length of slab will be 4 into 3, that is 12 meters. The load is being prescribed in the question. So moving forward, as we had discussed earlier, the first thing that we need to find out is whether we will be designing the slab to be one way or two way. For that, we need to find the aspect ratio. But in this case, it is mentioned in question that we need to design or we need to analyze a one-way slab, so no need to check the aspect ratio. And so in this case, the cross section of the slab is not being provided. The need of cross section that we have seen in the previous sum, the cross section was 3.2 meter cross 9.2 meter. So the need of cross section is to be given in question only if the aspect ratio is to be obtained. Here in this case, effective length of slab is already given in the question, so there is no need to get the value of the aspect ratio. So the first step in this case will be to find the effective depth. The procedure will be the same that we have discussed it earlier too. To find effective depth, we need to go to page number 37 and 38 of our IS code. So moving on to page number 37, the effective length is given in the question as 4 meters. So converting into mm, the answer comes out to be 4000 mm. The ratio, that is actual, the allowable LBD will be equal to 26 into mf. Why 26? Because on page number 36, the third case, that is for continuous beam or slab, it is given the value to be taken as 26. But keep in mind, it is not simply 26, it is 26 into mf, that is modification factor. So our equation comes out to be LBD equal to 26 mf. From this equation, always we need to find the value of d, that is small d, effective depth. And to find effective depth, we need to find the first case, that is mf. And to find mf, that is modification factor, we need to move on to page number 38, and we need to check this figure number 4. So from figure number 4, there are two axes. The first is the x-axis that contains the percentage of tension reinforcement, and the y-axis or the vertical axis that contains the modification factor. So we need to get the value of percentage of tension reinforcement, but as we are just starting our sum, the steel content is not given in the equation and still we have not designed our slab, so we need to assume the stuff. So first of all, for one-way slab, whether the slab is a simply supported slab or a continuous slab, the percentage reinforcement, that is PT, we will be always assuming it to be 0.6 for both the cases, that is for simply supported slab as well as for continuous slab. So for 0.6 percentage, we know that we will be focusing this vertical line, and as Fy is given in the question as 250, for calculating Fs, we will be concentrating on this equation, and in this case, the remaining portion or the last portion, that is AST or area of cross section of steel required upon area of cross section of steel provided, will be taken as 1 because we will be cancelling out these terms. So the equation will be just Fs equal to 0.58 Fy. And Fi is given in question as 250. So solving that, we'll be getting Fs equal to 145. So for this sum, we'll be focusing on this curve, that is Fs equal to 145. So intersecting this vertical line to this curve, we get somewhere here the modification factor. So for this case, the modification factor comes out to be 1.8, that is here somewhere. Yeah. So the MF or the modification factor comes out to be 1.8. Now substituting in the mine equation, that is L by D equal to 26 MF, substituting the value of MF to be 1.8, we get the answer small d, that is effective depth equal to 85.47 mm. Now keep in mind, there are two cases to be considered. The first one was one way simply supported slab, that to satisfy the checks, we always need to assume the depth to be 150 mm. Whether you are getting answer 100 or 80 or 90 or whatever, the minimum depth to be considered was 150 to satisfy our checks. In the case of our continuous slab, the minimum depth to be considered will be 120. So if you are considering the same thing to be 150, it is well and good, there is no issue. So the keep simplicity, if you want to get assume every time that for one way simply supported slab or continuous slab, if you are just assuming the value to be 150, that will be good. But the minimum case or the minimum value to be assumed in the case of one way continuous slab is 120 mm. So whenever you are getting an answer below 120, just assume that small d, that is effective depth, to be equal to 120 mm. So after the calculation of small d, that is effective depth, the next thing will be to calculate the overall depth. And for overall depth, the equation will be small capital D equal to small d plus 5 by 2 plus clear span, or you can say directly small d, that is effective depth plus the effective cover. And for main steel, as we have discussed earlier too, the bar or the diameter of bar, we will be always assuming it to be 10 mm. So assuming 10 mm diameter bars, 5 by 2 comes out to be 5 mm, and the clear cover we will be assuming it to be 20, or you can directly implement it as small d plus effective cover, and effective cover in that case comes out to be 25 mm. So in this case, the answer comes out to be 145 mm, that is for overall depth. So this was our step one. The step two would be of effective span, but in this case, effective span is already given in the question, so we'll be skipping that step and we'll be moving on to the third step, that is our load calculation. So in this case, our next step, that is step number two, will be load calculation. Now keep in mind, the changes that we'll be considering between that will be differentiating between a one-way continuous slab and a one-way simply supported slab will start from this step itself. Up till now, all the steps were same in both the cases, but from now onwards, that will be differentiating the cases. So for load calculations in one-way simply supported slab, we used to find three values, that was dead load or self weight, the second was our floor finish, and the third was our imposed load, and we were clubbing or we were getting the summation of all three these three cases. But for continuous beam, keep in mind, keep a note of it so you can remember it for your final examination too, for continuous beam, you need to solve separately the dead load and live load. You are not supposed to club it or to get a summation of it. So we'll be solving both the cases simultaneously and separately. That is, dead load will be calculated initially, and then we will be focusing on the live load part. We will not be clubbing and we will not be adding these two portions. Why so? We will be focusing that in the next slide. So for dead load of slab, to find the dead load of slab, that means to find the self weight, the equation comes out to be rho b d, that is density of RCC, which will be taking as 25 d, that will be always taking as capital D or overall depth. So in the last slide we saw that overall depth comes out to be 145 mm, so converting into meter it comes out to be 0.145. and in the previous sum we already discussed that we are always solving slab sections to be per meter of cross section. So whenever we are dealing with the width or breadth of the section, we'll always check B to be 1000 mm or 1 meter in each and every case of one way slabs. So B will be taking as 1. Solving it, we will be getting an answer 3.625. The next step will be to find floor finish, and floor finish is already given in the equation as 1 kilonewton per meter square. If it is not prescribed in equation, we will always be assuming it to be 1 kilonewton per meter square, and converting it into meter, that means multiplying by width, it comes out to be 1 into 1, that is 1. So we will club these two portions, that is we will be adding the dead load portion, which comes out to be 4.625. and after the calculation or after finding 4.625, we always know that this value is coming from the actual dimensions. So whenever we are getting the value from actual dimensions, we will be getting that value to be a working load. So the next step will be to calculate the factored load. So this will be a factored dead load that we'll be using in the design purposes, that is 6.94. This was our dead load portion. Now we'll be moving forward to the live load. Live load is given in the equation as 4 kilonewton per meter square. So again, calculating or converting it into kilonewton per meter, that is a UDL. So multiplying it by width, that is 1, we get an answer 4 kilonewton per meter. And converting it into factored load, why so? Because in the equation itself, it is not prescribed as the load to be factored. So whenever in the equation, if it is not given that the load is factored, you always need to multiply that load by 1.5. So the final live load comes out to be 6 kilonewton per meter, and the final dead load comes out to be 6.94 kilonewton per meter. Now our load calculation is completed. So we will be just referring our both cases, that the first case was one way simply supported slab. So in that case or in that sum, the next step of ours will be to find the bending moment calculations, or to find the bending moment. And we all know that whenever we are dealing with a simply supported beam or a simply supported slab, the equation for maximum bending moment will always be WL square by 8 in the case of a UDL load, that is a uniformly distributed load. So in the case of continuous beam, the equation WL square by 8 is not applicable. So here the changes start. Okay? So we'll be focusing that how we will be calculating the bending moment and which page of your IS code will be using that. Next step will be to find bending moment or to get the bending moment calculations. For that, we'll be referring to page number 36 of your IS code. So I request all to pause this video and take your IS code, go to page number 36, as it is the most important topic in the slab portion. So after moving on to page number 36, you get a table that is into this form. Table number 12, the title of it is bending moment coefficients. That means the bending moment coefficients are mentioned in this table. We will be using these coefficients to find our actual bending moment answers. Okay? So looking forward to the table, there are basically two rows being prescribed. The first column is type of load. The first type is dead load and imposed load. But keep in mind, it is mentioned as dead load and imposed load, in bracket it is given as fixed, that means fixed live load. And fixed live load, that is none other than our floor finish. Clear? So the first combination, as you have seen in the code itself, the first combination is dead load plus floor finish. So in the previous step, we calculated dead load and floor finish differently as compared to our live load for getting the use in this case. So the first case will be DL plus FF, and the second case you can see here is imposed load not fixed. That means the live load given in the question. So we have bifurcated our two cases to be in this form. Now moving on to the further columns, the first two columns are for span moments, and the third and fourth column is for support moments. Now keep in mind, it is a continuous beam, so we will be getting more than two supports and more than one span. In the case of simply supported beam, it was very simple, as we were getting just two supports and one span, and we all know that on end supports the moment is zero, so we were not at all focusing on the support reactions or the support moments, we were just focusing on the mid span moment. But in this case there will be total three mid spans, as there are three spans and total there will be four supports. So we will be moving forward to a sketch that will be prescribing our actual beam, which will be something like this. As you can see here in the question, it is given that our slab is equally divided into three span of 4 meter each. So this will be my first span of 4 meter, this will be my second span of 4 meter, and this will be my third span of 4 meter. So in this case I can say that total there are four supports and three spans that will be calculating. So this will be my support A, B, C, and this last one will be my D. As we all know that the end supports doesn't carry any moment, so it is simpler that moment at A and moment at D will be equal to zero. So the rest moments we need to calculate, and for that we will be using this table that is given in our IAS code. But keep in mind, these equations, as you can see here, are just equations or are just coefficients. This is not the perfect value of it. So how to calculate the perfect value of it? For that you need to refer this note that is mentioned below our table. It says that for obtaining the bending moment, the coefficient shall be multiplied by total design load and effective span. Clear? It is very important to be noted that the total coefficients, that means the values that are prescribed in this table, these are the total coefficients, or the coefficients shall be multiplied by total design load, that means dead load and live load, and the effective span. Clear? So from this we will be getting our value of bending moment. So we will be focusing each and everything simultaneously, and for that we will be giving a nomenclature of every terms. As you can see here, I have bifurcated and given names or nomenclatures to each and every point. These supports will be my A, B, C, and D. E and G will be my span moments of end span, whereas F will be my span moment or the mid span moment for my middle span. And how to calculate or how to verify these cases, we will be focusing on each and every detail. For example, we will be first focusing on the span moments. Span moments, that means E, F, and G. We will be dealing with the terms, that is E and F, E, F, and G. So here in the first case, you can see that it is mentioned near middle of end span, near middle of end span. So out of these three spans, which will be the end spans? So the end spans will be AB and CD. So the AB portion and CD portion will be our end span, and it is given as we need to check or we need to find that middle of end span. So the middle of end span will be E and G. So this first column, we'll be getting the values for moment at E and G. So calculating moment of E and G will be focused in the column number 1. Now moving forward to our point F. F is again a span moment, but it is not mentioned in the end span, it is in the intermediate spans. So for that we'll be focusing in column 2. Column 2 is for span moments, and it is mentioned that at middle of interior spans. So interior span, there is only one interior span, as total there are three spans, out of which two will be the end span and one, that is the center portion, that is BC. BC will be our interior span. So on the middle of interior span, that means F. So to calculate the bending moment at F, we will be focusing on column number 2. So from this, E, F, and G will be calculated. Now moving on to the second portion, that is support moment. Now support moments, that means moment at A, B, C and D. But as we all know that the end supports do not carry any moment. So directly moment at A and moment at D will be zero. We will be just focusing on moment at B and moment at C. For that, we'll be looking forward to the column number 3 and column number 4. Column number 3 says that at support next to end support. Why next to end support? Because at end support, we don't get any moment. So we'll be just focusing on the next to the end support. So here, again repeating, at support next to the end support. End supports are A and D. So to next of end support will be B and C. So to calculate the moments at B and C, we'll be focusing in column number 3. Column number 4 will not be taking in this sum. If there are 5 supports, then column number 4 will be coming into picture. Now for this sum itself, we'll be focusing on column number 1, 2 and 3. Column number 1, that is this column, will be for end span, that is E and G. This column, that is center column, will be for F, and this column of support moments will be used for calculating B and C. So how we'll be calculating? We'll be checking that first we'll be finding bending moment at E and G. Both will be the same cases. As we all know that these are just the coefficients, and we need to multiply it by design load and effective span. We have bifurcated the design load into two parts, that is a dead load and live load. So first we will be calculating moment of dead load, which will be denoted by MDL. So moment at dead load, the values will be WL square by 12. Why 12? Because here the coefficient is 12. Clear? Don't just keep in mind that the previous sums we were dealing with the answer WL square by 12. So again we will be using this sum, that is WL square by 12. Here the coefficient is 12. So we are inserting this value to be WL square by 12. Or you can directly mention that as 1 by 12 of W into L square. That will be good enough. 1 by 12 of W into L square. W into L square, it is mentioned in the note that we need to multiply it by that. And 1 by 12 is our coefficient. So solving that, we get an answer 9.25 kilonewton per meter. Now moving on to the live load, the coefficient of live load is 1 by 10. So our equation becomes 1 by 10 into WL square, or directly WL square by 10. So the answer comes out to be 9.6 kilonewton per meter. Now we'll be clubbing or adding these values. So after finding the bending moment, we'll be clubbing it, and the answer comes out to be 18.85 kilonewton per meter. So the moment at E and G comes out to be 18.85 kilonewton per meter. This was our end span moments. Now we'll be focusing on the center portion, that is F. So to calculate moment at F, we'll be focusing on this column, and for that the coefficient of dead load will be 1 by 16, and the coefficient of live load will be 1 by 12. So we'll be getting these answers, and clubbing that we'll be getting final answer 14.94 kilonewton per meter. Now focusing on the support moments. So support moments, will be getting two moments in this case, that is moment at B and moment at C. Both will be the same answer. So moment at B and C, for that we'll be seeing this column number 3. So for column number 3, you can see that the coefficients are negative, and by so we need to check here the bending moment diagram. If we just assume the slab to be of portion A to B, then the bending of slab will be something like this, that is sagging moment. We are not dealing with the extension portions, just the portion A and B. So for sagging moment, we all know that for sagging the moment will be positive. But if I get, or if I counter the rest portion or remaining portion, then by including the supports, that is by including the supports B, C and D, now the end supports are A and D. My end supports are A and D. So after calculating, or after finding the bending moment diagram, my diagram comes out to be something like this. So in the mid-span portion, we always get a sagging moment, and near supports, we always get the hogging moment. keep in mind. And suppose we always get the moments to be hogging nature. And for hogging nature, we all know that the bending moment is negative. So for hogging or for supports, we are always getting the value to be negative. And for center or mid-span portion, we are always getting the value to be positive. Keep in mind, this can be asked in your VIVAS questions or for MCQ examination, that why we are substituting value to be positive and negative in these cases. So moving forward, calculating the bending moment calculation for B and C, we'll be referring this column. So for dead load, it will be minus WL square by 10. We'll be getting an answer 11.11 negative. And for live load, we'll be substituting this coefficient, that is minus 1 by 9. So total, we'll be getting this load, that is minus 21.77 kilonewton per meter. So this was our load calculation or bending moment calculation. And the next thing will be to check whether up till now we have covered the topic perfectly or not. And for that, we will be always looking forward to the check, that is effective depth for flexure. So we'll always look for this check, that is effective depth for flexure. And for that, we will be again using the same cases. Mu will be equal to 0.148 FCQ BD square. Why 0.148? Because in the question it's prescribed as Fe 250 steel. For mild steel, we'll always take the value of Mu limb to be 0.148 FCK BD square. MU. Now keep in mind, there are various values of MU that we have considered. Always substitute the maximum value that you obtain here. Negative positive, which in this case comes out to be 21.77 in 10 raised to 6. Width will again be per meter, so 1 meter. This, solving this, we get D to be 85.76 mm, and we have provided 120 mm. Up till now, our sum is perfect regarding this portion, that is our bending moment calculation. Now we'll be designing the steel content. And to design the steel content, we will be need to check one thing, that is a basic thing or the basic requirement, that is bent up bars. For continuous beam or continuous slab, we always need to find and we always need to check the bent up bars. Now what do you mean by bent up bars? So for that, we'll be referring this figure. As you can see here, bent up bars, as the name suggests, bent up means the bars that are bent in upward direction, and these are provided at junction point. Junction point means where the bars of our slab will be coinciding with the bars of either beam or column. So to overcome this resistance or to overcome this alignment, we are just providing a bent up. As you can see here, these are the bent ups that are provided near the support portion, means the bars are bent in the upward direction to resist or to directly get through this portion. And why we are providing this bent up bar? There are basically four reasons for that. You can keep a note of it. This can be asked in your examination too. The first thing is to resist the hogging moments at the supports. The second is to counter the failure of slabs. The third is to encounter the shear force that we have not discussed up till now. The shear force is always greater in the section of support. As you all know, the shear force will be maximum at supports and minimum at the mid span. And the fourth and final reason will be by providing crank, the strength of slab is increased. Now what do you mean by crank? Crank means this distance. This distance up to which the bar is elevated, this distance is called crank. Crank means the portion where we are elevating our bar from tension zone to compression zone. This is called crank portion. So these are the basic reasons or purposes of why we are providing a bent up bars. So for designing our steel content, we will be referring and we will be using this bent up sections, which we will be covering in the next lecture. So up till now, we will be keeping up to this, and in the next lecture, we will be designing our steel content and we will be looking forward to the more sums. Thank you.